What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous videos of this series, we introduced Docker containers, images, and learned how to create our own image using a Docker file. In today's video, we're going to take the Spring Boot application we created in our Spring Boot series, wrap it inside of a Docker container, and then access that web application from a browser running on our local machine. So, the first thing we must do is retrieve that application. Now, if you don't have any experience with Spring Boot, that is totally fine. The code we're using is totally optional. You can pick any application of your choice. However, if you decide to use that same application, feel free to check our Spring Boot series linked in the card above. After retrieving this app, we're going to build a Docker file to create an image that is going to be used to run our web server inside of a container. So, we're going to build the image from the Docker file, we will run the image as a container on our local machine, and then we will make sure that we are able to connect to that running web application inside the container from our browser. Now, before kicking it off, I'm going to throw a disclaimer out there. We're going to do some things a little bit wrong, so we're going to make a couple of mistakes and we're doing them on purpose. Because there are some mistakes that I expect you to make when you start working with Docker, so I want you to see these mistakes, I want you to see the error messages, and I want you to learn how to fix them. Okay, so we've got our source code here, and now we need to figure out how we can wrap this all up inside of a Docker container. What are the series of operations that we are going to put in the Docker file? Well, whatever they are, our file is going to end up looking very similar to what we did in the last video. So if we bring back the template we followed, you can see that we first need to specify a base image, run some command to install some dependencies, and then specify the command to run on startup. So we're going to take this type of approach right here by creating a Docker file and then essentially create three lines with almost exactly these instructions inside it. In the previous video, we made use of Alpine as our base image. Let's keep it for now. Okay, the next couple instructions are providing Docker with the files it needs to run that application and then actually run it. But let's take a step back and think. If we were to run this application from the command line, how do we do that in Java? Well, we will first need to compile our code to generate the jar files, right? Then we simply run the java-jar command on the file we generated. After doing that, our application will be accessible from the browser. That's it. And that is exactly what we will tell Docker to do. So we will first tell Docker to copy those jars files into the containerized space reserved for it by making use of the copy command. And then the command to run or the startup command will be the exact same one we made use of on our terminal. Let's hit the Docker build command followed by Docker run and see what we get. Now, because our application is written in Java, we got an error saying that Java was not found. And indeed, the Alpine image you are using as base image does not come pre-configured with Java. Now, to solve this issue, we have two options. The first option is to find a different base image, or we can continue using the Alpine image and run an additional command to install Java inside of our image. In our case, we're going to use someone else's image. We're going to find an image that has already been configured to have Java pre-installed inside it. And if we navigate to hub.docker.com, search for Java or JRE, we'll see multiple Java images listed. Go ahead and pick a non-deprecated one. In this video, we will be making use of the one you see in front of you and launch the Docker run command again. Alright, so we can see that the command was issued and that the server is currently listening on port 8080. We're ready to open a web browser and test this thing out. Let's flip over to the browser and visit localhost 8080. But once we do, we'll get an error message saying this site can't be reached. Well, we got our image built and we are running a container out of it, but we are still not able to visit this port or see the web application running. Why? Well, our browser is making a request to localhost 8080, which is essentially a reference to your current machine on port 8080, and by default, no traffic that is coming onto your computer or onto your localhost network is routed into the container. So the container essentially has its own isolated set of ports that can receive traffic, but by default, no incoming traffic to your computer is going to be directed into the container. To make sure that any request from your computer will be redirected into the container, we must set up an explicit port mapping. A port mapping essentially says that anytime someone makes a request to a given port on the local network, take that request and automatically forward it to some port inside the container. Now, one thing I want to make sure is clear right now from the get-go, we are only talking here about incoming requests. The Docker container can by default make requests on its own behalf to the outside world. It is strictly a limitation on the ability for incoming traffic to get into the container. So, to set up this mapping, to kind of forward this traffic to a specific port inside the container, We're going to make a slight adjustment to the way in which we start the container, or specifically the Docker run command. This is not a change that we're going to make to the Docker file. We do not set up port forwarding inside the Docker file. The port forwarding stuff is strictly a runtime constraint. In other words, it's something that we only change when we run a container or start a container. So we're going to add a -p flag. The overall syntax will be the docker run -p. Then we're going to specify that any incoming traffic on our local network to this port on the left side of the dots should be automatically forwarded onto that port on the right side inside the container. Okay, it looks like everything is still identical to how it was before, but if you flip over to your browser, open a new tab, and go to the localhost 8080, you'll very quickly see that we get the swagger page we are expecting. So that means that we are now correctly forwarding incoming requests into the container. The application is processing the request and then sending a response back. That is port mapping in a nutshell. Note also that the port from the source machine that you are mapping from to the port that you are mapping to inside the container do not have to be identical. So you could easily say that anytime a request comes into localhost 5000, for example, redirect that request to 8080 inside the container. And if you go ahead and try that, you'll see that everything will start up successfully. Now, let's go back to our Docker file and tackle one best practice we can apply. Don't worry, we will attempt to cover more of these in upcoming videos. But for now, notice how our jar file and supposedly the dependencies it needs are all placed into the root directory of this container, and this is not best practice. The reason for that is if we happen to have any files or folders that conflict with a default folder system name, we might accidentally overwrite some existing files or folders inside the container, which is not ideal. So we're going to make a little change to our Docker file, and rather than copying everything directly into the root project directory, we're going to copy everything into a nested directory instead. Now, rather than just changing the copy command, there's an instruction that we can use inside the Docker file that is specifically meant to address this whole issue. We can add the workdir or the work directory instruction into the Docker file and then pass a folder reference to it. Then any following commands or any following instructions we add to our Docker file will be executed relative to this folder. So, in other words, if the copy command is underneath the workdir one, it will copy its files into the directory that we have specified as the working directory. Let's go back to the terminal and attach to that container in startup a shell inside it. By using docker exec-it, if you recall this from our previous videos, notice that when we enter, we are directly thrown into the opt/myapp folder because we set it up as working directory. And if we ls right here, we'll see our jar nicely isolated inside of this directory. There's one last little interesting thing that I want to show you about our current build process before ending the video. To do that, let's try making a change in our app and regenerate our jar file. In this example, I just removed one of the APIs. If we docker run the new image generated via port mapping and go to the browser, you'll notice that the expected results appear on the screen even though no changes were made to the docker file itself nor to the jar file name generated. Our new development was like that, just deployed. What we just witnessed constitutes one of the main building blocks behind the CD part of what you may have heard of as CI/CD, which stands for Continuous Integration and Continuous Deployment, which we will make sure to further expand on in upcoming videos of this series, so stay tuned. And before we sign off, we would like to announce that we just launched our Patreon. So if you'd like to support us, you can click on the link in the description below. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.